starting back on our desert magazine days. So hopefully you can all see this. All right, so Desert Magazine. As I said, Beal's friendship with Jepson was basically unknown, probably would be unknown for everyone except for people like me who actually look at these sorts of archival collections that are held at different, at the Jepson Herbarium, which most herbaria actually don't have archival collections. That's sort of rare. And it seems likely, because only people like me would know about her, that Beal would have fallen into complete obscurity were it not for her forays into the popular publication world. And by this, I mean Desert Magazine, which if you want to find out more about the Desert Magazine, you can tune in next month for my Desert Magazine talk. And her regular pieces in Desert Magazine provided her with an income beyond what she got from the little sums that Willis Linn Jepson would send her to support her botanizing and whatever she got from her family. So it was really one of her main sources of income. And luckily for her, Desert Magazine had its own cult of personality and collection of devoted readers emanating in part from its proprietor, Randall Henderson. Henderson, who began as a prominent newspaperman in places like Blythe and El Centro in the 1920s, eventually made his way to Palm Springs, where he was both a newspaperman and one of the partners in developing what is now the city of Palm Desert. Devoted followers of the magazine not only read the pieces in it, like Randall's Between You and Me columns, which provided updates on his life from the desert, whether it was the North African desert during World War II or his home in Palm Desert during less turbulent times, but these devoted followers, they were really dedicated to the purpose and the project of Desert Magazine, which could lead them across the desert in search of new gems to find or new plants to botanize. And that's certainly what they were doing when they were reading Mary Beal's articles. And so maybe it was Mary Beal's botanizing spirit that kept people coming back to her articles. Or maybe it was just that her pieces were just like between everything else that they were reading in the magazine, and they might as well read a botany article. If they were close readers, though, they would actually know the first time that Mary Beal appeared in the pages of the magazine, which is when she won second place for her picture of mammillaria blossoms in the 1938 October issue, of course. This is just an example of the Between You and Me column that Randall Henderson would put out. So this was just sort of, you know, like a beginning or end of the magazine column. And then here we have on the bottom, Mammillaria Blossoms, Mary Beal, Daggett, D-A-G-G-E-T-T, California. Second prize with a fancy Corona with a K camera. And about a year later, Mary Beal's first article was published in the Desert Magazine, and it was one of 56 appearances in the magazine she'd have over the years. Her works in the magazine, which were all published between 1939 and 1953, were not always great. So I've read a lot of them. Some of them are good. Some of them are just downright bad. But regardless, many readers came to love them. One of her standard literary devices for talking about plants was anthropomorphizing her botanical subjects. So she would talk about old man mesquite, for example. But even worse, for people like me, people who really dislike unnecessary comparisons between people and plants, she would talk about the desert dandelion. So let me just read you a line from this like horrible, horrible line. Desert dandelion is a lovely flower, but such a sleepyhead. She toddles off to bed while the sun is still high above the western horizon and sleeps the long night through till old soul is high in the heavens the next morning. Wow, that is, gosh, just this exactly the sort of thing I hate. So after she would have these sorts of like flowery descriptions, Mary Beal would move on to much drier topics. She would describe the plants sort of extensively, often in the sort of detail that you would associate with like, you know, less so with someone who likes plants and more so with someone who studies plants. So she would like really go through and be like, well, this plant is sort of similar to this plant, but if you like look and then like there's a little hair on the little stem and that's how you can tell the difference, like those sorts of details. And this level of detail actually gave the articles pretty good botanical accuracy, if that's what you were reading Desert Magazine for. But I think that this was probably not appreciated by all readers of Desert Magazine. This is just my guess. And sometimes her columns, in addition to doing this sort of like flowery descriptions and then having these great details about how to identify plants, she would also shed some light on just sort of like common things that people say about plants. So sometimes she would dispel a good myth about a plant, or she would tell us how they got their names. So her first article, just as an example, featured the desert agave, which is known also as the century plant, which does not actually bloom once a century, but once every couple of dozen years, as she writes in the article. Her articles also included the uses of plants as well, drawing on her readings and interactions with Native Americans in the area, most likely Chemehuevis, Mojaves, and Serranos. In one early article, she features chia, which some of you might be familiar with, and she described how it had been used historically by local Native Americans for food, and also includes a tidbit describing how her landlord, Theodore Strong Van Dyke, would use chia to sustain him for a long day of hunting. And so she was also familiar with this use, and she was known to pack chia with her for all-day botanizing expeditions. And though it was just as often as not that her articles failed in creating, oh, and I actually have, oh, I forgot to show you the desert dandelion. Sorry, guys, this is the desert dandelion article. And then here's the chia article. And so as I was saying, though it's just as often as not that her articles failed in creating a compelling or beautiful or even interesting narrative, she sometimes succeeded in finding both accurate and poetic descriptions of the desert plants rather than old and tired and cliched ones. For example, her description of the ghost flower captures how its blossoms are like a swarm of butterflies settled down to rest. And so what I think her most successful articles are the ones where she actually describes her feelings of discovering plants and reflects on the kinds of excitement that she has on these sorts of botanizing expeditions. And so my favorite is about her rediscovery of this flower known as stick leaf semilla or Mencelia involucrata. And so she thought she was never going to see this plant again and that she had even dreamt it into existence. And so she says, since that first discovery of semilla, I have looked for other specimens in Ord Mountain and elsewhere, but it was not until many years later that I found one lone flower, a rather runty one at that, near Chloride, Arizona. Even in its better known haunts in the Colorado desert, it eluded me. If it had not been for a photograph I had taken of that Ord Mountain specimen, I would have doubted my memory of finding it. And so after this Arizona discovery, the runty one, she has the good fortune to stumble upon semilla in a specimen box that someone had delivered to her house, because people just send you plants in the mail, which actually led her to a, quote, treasure trove beyond my most wishful dreams in the Bullion Mountains, which is just, it's just lovely to hear someone like get to discover the plant that they were looking for. And so this is the little story that's about that. But her biggest success in Desert Magazine was just due to the fact that Desert Magazine was ridiculously popular at this time. Randall Henderson's columns, right, called Between You and Me, were so popular because people actually thought that they were like getting a connection to him and getting a connection to the desert through the magazine, even though it was often the case that they never actually went to the desert themselves. And so Mary Beal, like Randall Henderson, for some people was actually, you know, a regular in their lives. And so some subscribers, they would never go out to the desert. They would never see any of these plants that she wrote about. But for others, they would get to meet Mary Beal. So Althea Hill, who is a Desert Magazine reader and one of the few lucky people to meet Mary Beal, described her experience in a letter to the editor in 1946. Quote, continuing to Daggett, we were looking for a camping spot and asked directions of a lady bound for the post office. Her hospitality included a welcome to a secluded and shady table under the cottonwoods at the Van Dyke Ranch. Then we learned that the woman who had been so kind to us was your writer, speaking, of course, to the magazine, Mary Beal. She showed me her writing den with its arrays of books and knickknacks and Indian baskets. Her next botany article was sticking out of the little red typewriter. She writes with such authority, and her articles are spiced with a sense of humor that attracts even a novice in the field of botany. And so she was probably humanized by these little pieces about her that end up appearing in the magazine, as well as a couple of times when she appears in the magazine as, you know, a person, not just someone who talks about plants. Oh, and here's this letter from Althea, which is this long one on the top left. And so this rock hounding in the Cadiz is one of the articles when she appears. And what we can see in these short sketches that appear about Mary Beal in the magazine is just how excited she gets about seeing plants when they go around a turn, when she exclaims, there they are, at some giant nolinas that were seen supposedly far out of their range at their time, when she's out with geographer Richard Logan in 1953. But what I think this one by Harold Waite is probably the best moment where we can really see a lot about Mary Beal. And so this is from December 1948, as you can see in that bottom left corner. And the start of the article is about Mary Beal. Quote, if you should come upon a small active woman in some isolated corner of the Mojave, wrapped about with photographic equipment and clinging to the canyon wall with fingers and toes, while she decides whether to study a flower or investigate a mineral specimen, it will be quite safe to say, hello, Mary Beal. I just think that's fabulous. And so these are pictures of Mary Beal out and about in the field. According to Harold Waite, Mary Beal will take any excuse to get out to the desert, and looking at rocks fit the bill as much as botanizing would. And the article, if you read through it, which you can now actually, so all of the Desert Magazine magazines are up online on the internet, you can hunt them down. You can see through this article, which is almost a profile of Mary, how she came to love the desert, the place that she had initially expected to be the godforsaken place. And so, like many of you all who all love going out to the desert, Mary Beal in this article represents something that we all get excited about, the thrill of just going out and getting out there. And so, but beyond these couple of glimpses into Mary Beal's life and her correspondence with Willis Linn Jepson, it's actually pretty hard to tell what's actually going on in her life. Her diaries, which are some of which are held over at the Mojave Desert Heritage Association in Goffs, are not really records of her inner life as they were records of the books that she read. And so you can learn all about the books that she read, which some of which are sort of like some desert classics. We got some Mary Austin in there, some George Wharton James, and then we have some other sort of like classics, just, you know, world classics. So we got Mark Twain, Booker T. Washington, and some of them were just books of the times. Things like The Spinster Book by Myrtle Reed or The Law of Psychic Phenomena by Hadsoe. Neither of which I've heard ever again after seeing them in there. As much of the diary is just a dry list of botanized here today, botanized there today, they have the occasional quip or story worth reading. So I'm just going to share a couple of those with you now. Quote, the rear wall of one store bears this inscription in large, crude letters. In God we trust, but in Calico we starve. And so that was undoubtedly about the mining time, the end of the mining times in Calico. But even though we have some fun quips like this, you know, we don't really know that much about Mary Beal. She, unlike these other famous biographical subjects, some of whom actually appeared in this talk earlier, like, we don't know very much about her at all. And even to people who she knew or people who she lived next to, you know, for most of her life as a neighbor, that would be Dix Van Dyke, she was strangely formal, despite the fact that everyone called her Mammy. We know about some of her friends, right? We know she went out to the Mitchell Caverns to hang out with Jack and Ida Mitchell, but we don't know that much about their friendship. And we really only know that she liked to hang out in the Providence Mountains, but who wouldn't, honestly? And so the best, what I think is probably the best insight into her own life and what she thought is in her published work. And really, it's just this one piece in the Calico print. This is a picture of the Cadiz where you can see their magnificent colors from earlier, why you would rock hound there. Calico print, which was run by Lucille and Harold Waite, right? And Harold Waite was a regular, both of them actually were regular writers for Desert Magazine. And Harold was the person who wrote this article about rock hounding in the Cady Mountains. And her piece in the 1951 edition of the Calico print, which was called When John O'Byrd Saw Calico about John Burroughs, was at once her like most poetic piece and her least botanical piece. And it was a moment where she really like showed her love for the desert without hiding behind anthropomorphized or overly scientific descriptions of plants. And so this essay about meeting John Burroughs in the desert, I would argue, is the greatest expression of her time in the place, showing the portrait of the man who introduced her to the desert and her own true love of the place. So now I'm going to read you a shortened version of this essay until the end of the talk, pretty much. So she says, "The name of John Burroughs brings thoughts of green pastures and verdure-clad hills, woods, and running streams. The sylvan and pastoral divinities which held his affections are a far cry from desert wastes. But once, as my guest, he spent a little time in the Mojave, and its very strangeness aroused his interest. It was because of John Burroughs that I first came to the Van Dyke Ranch near Daggett. I had been friends with him while I worked at the Riverside Library between 1906 and 1910 and had been invited to spend the summer of 1910 at the Burroughs home on the Hudson. But a severe case of pneumonia left me in such a condition that the trip was impossible and I had to plan instead to go into the mountains to attempt to regain my health. When Burroughs heard of this, he wrote, 'I wish you would consider the desert instead.' He told me of John Muir's daughter, Helen, who had gone to the desert after suffering pneumonia and had recovered completely. 'Write John Muir,' he insisted. I wrote, and then at Muir's request, to his daughter, and in a week I was on the way to the ranch and life in a tent house. In January 1911, John Burroughs and his wife were on their way to California, stopping at the Grand Canyon en route. They planned to stop at Daggett to visit me, but Mrs. Burroughs' health was uncertain, and she decided to stay on a few days at the canyon rather than risk the unknown quantity of a desert ranch or small frontier hotel. But for Burroughs, he wrote, 'I can sleep on a cot or a haymow if need be.'" Just editorial note here, John Burroughs, also very famous for being a philanderer. Just a FYI. So owing to a delayed telegram, no one met him at the station, and he made his way on foot to the ranch a mile away. But he had insisted that he enjoyed keenly the walk on the desert in the fresh early morning air. After the first day was given over, as one might be expected, to watching the birds and walks about the ranch. The matchless blue of the mountain bluebird fluttering over the winter-browned alfalfa fields, a large flock of tiny pipits walking sedately about with bobbing heads and tilting tails, robins laughing all over the place, meadowlarks caroling a phrase of spring-like melody, flocks of horned larks suddenly springing from the ground and wheeling about with tinkling bits of song, the quick, strong flight of the red-shafted flicker, even the activities of an industrious gopher, all came in for interested attention. But the omnipresent white-crowned gambled sparrows won John O'Bird's heart. Scores of them made themselves at home in my tiny tent house beside a cottonwood tree. As we sat on the porch, they hopped about our feet and fluttered all around us, unafraid, chirping and chattering like a lot of happy children at play. Across the valley, the Calico Mountains, deep red and terracotta, overlaid with a thin veil of purple, were suffused with glowing light. The ethereal blue of the farther eastern ranches, softened by distance, became delicate pastels of pink and mauve in the late afternoon light. John Burroughs saw the beauty and strength of the vast solitude and felt the charm of sky and mountain coloring, but forgot not the human nature in the midst of it. What is the life of this little town, he questioned. What do people do and what are they like? What are their interests? On our way down the slope, we met a little brown owl that faced about and bobbed a quick curtsy as if glad to meet and pay homage to John O'Birds, and Burroughs was as delighted as if it had been a human friend. All the day, the calicos had been alluring with their patchwork of color, maroon splotched with orange, green, lavender, and tawny. The next morning, the sky was partially overcast, the sun peeping through the clouds only at intervals. But the calicos still beckoned, violet and deep velvety purple under the threatening clouds. With my horse, Dolly Varden, in a runabout, we set forth. As we drove across the desert towards the calicos' barren ruggedness, all seamed and scarred, Burroughs exclaimed, "What a contrast to our mountains! You have never seen our eastern mountains, have you?" "No, never." "They have long, flowing lines, very restful to the eye and spirit. How novel they would seem to you, with the farms, score of them, lying tilted across the wooded mountains at a gentle angle, basking in the sun. But these mountains are lean, bony, angular, alert, and threatening. After the lapse of ages, when time has worn them down and softened them, they may look as ours look. Our mountains were old, old before yours were born." After a few miles, the road crossed a dry lake, smooth and firm as pavement, a mile in width and twice that long, whose borders, when the sun shone, gave the perfect illusion of water, reflecting the growth along the margin and even the mountains 20 miles away. From the dry lake, the way lay up a slope, much washed and strewn with boulders and rocks of varied hue, swept down by the torrents of water that cloudbursts now and then let loose on the desert. John Burroughs was very much interested in the rock streams, and we stopped several times to inspect individual rocks and pick up small specimens. The clouds darkened, and a light mist began to fall as the slope steepened to the uplift of the mountains. Here we were joined by Mr. Clifford, a friendly horseman with whom we had arranged to share our outing. He thoughtfully added to our protecting covers a heavy tarp and a big slicker, welcome acquisitions as the mist soon turned into rain. A short distance farther up the mountain, the road ended past the ghost town of Calico. There were a few more buildings in those days, but the only inhabitants were three chloriders working in the old tunnels, the Mulcahy brothers of Daggett. We made the deserting mining camp our headquarters for the day. Our horses were installed in the half-ruined drugstore, and we took possession of the old dance hall. The only reminder of its former gaiety was the wreck of a piano, the keys missing and front casing gone. The door of an old safe, brought in from a rubbish heap, made a foundation for a small campfire upon which we made coffee, heated a can of soup, and boiled hops. It was still raining half-heartedly after lunch, and we persuaded Burroughs to put on the slicker, which, meant for a much larger man, dragged on the ground. Belted up and bloused over, its impeding length was remedied, but it made him look like a cross between a friar and a pirate. Would we call that a friarate? Who knows? When the men returned from their tour of the camp, the rain had ceased, and we all went down into Wall Street Canyon, upon the eastern wall of which the old town of Calico had been built. Here was a geologist's paradise, with huge boulders and rocks and more rocks. The walls were worn and eroded, and everywhere in structure and substance gave evidence of volcanic disturbance. In the open stretch, we indulged in target practice. Though it had been long since he had handled a gun, Burroughs' eye was as true and his arm as steady as that of a youth. And what a picture he made in his friar pirate garb in that wild setting, standing erect with a long-barreled 32 balanced in his outstretched hand. His white hair and beard and gentle expression were strangely at variance with his queer apparel and occupation. "How I should like to visit this place with an expert geologist," Burroughs said. "How I'd like to go through these mountains with John Muir." Driving home later in the afternoon, the clearing star gave us beautiful sky, rather, gave us beautiful lights and shadows of the, on the mountains and enchanting sunset colors, a picture of a desert for him to treasure in his memory. The next morning, our naturalist wanted to see the pipits again and the mountain bluebirds in the little time before his train arrived. And there they were in the same field as before, as if waiting for us. Then he took a final look at the rugged calicos and exclaimed, as he had the day before, "How these mountains show their teeth. I wish you could see my tree-clad mountains. They're fat and smooth as babies." The Calico Mountains made a lasting impression on John Burroughs, and he planned to come back for a desert sojourn. They would drive out and bring a tent for sleeping. They would stay a week so that he could loaf and invite his soul, and, as he said, and go back to see the Calico Mountains again. But something always prevented the trip. In March 1921, I saw him when he was ill in the Pasadena hospital, and he spoke of it regretfully. "I wanted to see the Calico Mountains," he said. "I wanted to see those mountains, but I fear I never will. You'll have to go see them for me." And so she did. And that is it, everyone. So if anyone has questions, please throw them up in the chat. Or I think Gabashia might go through some of our comments too.
Let me see if anybody has any questions. You can either pop them in the question, in the ask the question button, or on the chat right now. I don't think we've received any questions throughout the presentation. So
also feel free to ask questions about Daggett. Daggett's a cool place.
I actually have a couple of questions myself. So while everybody is submitting, maybe we can go through those.
For sure.
I was curious about how you learned first about Mary Beal and how you got interested in that.
Yeah, now I'm like trying to remember. How did I first learn about her? It was probably during one of my Desert Magazine obsession phases. Because I really spent a lot of time just like really reading a lot of old desert magazines. And so I think I just really started on that. But there's sort of this incredible resource in what this English professor, Peter Wild, put together about the California desert. And so she appears sort of like sideways in a lot of the things that he wrote about.
Cool.
It looks like we have one question in the chat, which is about the ghost flower or the sand blazing star. So the picture that I put up was of the sand blazing star, but the description that I said right before the picture was from a different article because I forgot to put up that picture from the other article, the ghost flower one, if that answers your question. But I can actually, let me just look in my notes and I can tell you where it, like which issue of Desert Magazine it appeared in. In case, you know, just in case this is a thing that you're curious about, because obviously that is what other people, so the ghost flower description came from this April 1948 Desert Magazine issue. And then, of course, the Mencilia involucrata, that one was in the June 1941 issue. So if you want to check those out online, you can find those.
Is there a better place to find those online or just Googling it?
Actually, so the website is called, I think it's called Desert Magazine, but with a Z. But there are a couple of places where you can access them, and it's sort of like it has been periodically changing. So I think it might all be here. So I'm just going to put this actually in
the if you can drop it in the chat.
Yeah, drop it in the chat in case people want to find it. But we'll also be learning more about Desert Magazine in coming weeks. So don't worry if you can't make it all the way through the archives, because it's a little bit of a big archive.
I have another question. Do you have a favorite quote from Mary Beal?
I just think that like some of the things that she says about the plants are just like really funny and interesting. So I really put all my favorite things that she says in there. I also have a true love for this whole friar pirate thing. I think that's like so silly. because like John Burroughs was such a prominent nature writer of that time. It's just so funny that she is really like giving us a personal side of him. And that like, you know, he could never be prepared for it to be raining when they're going out in the desert someday and they're just stuck, you know?
Yeah, that's hilarious. We have a couple of people in the chat. I think somebody wants to learn about your passion for the desert.
Yeah. So I guess there are many ways. I really love the desert, obviously. I spend a lot of time there, and I do my dissertation research on land management issues in the California desert. One of the reasons why I'm giving this talk is because I think it's really important to like share knowledge about the desert and get other people jazzed about it. Because one of the biggest issues, especially for contemporary protection of historical and ecologically important places in the desert, is like letting people know how cool it is and why we should be protecting it. Because I am thoroughly convinced that if you spend only even a little bit of time in the desert, that you will come to love it, and therefore that you will want to protect it with the same sort of like, you know, vivaciousness that all of my friends have for the desert.
That's beautiful. Thanks for sharing that. We have another question that's more history related. Mm-hmm. Linda is saying there was a lot of military training going on in the area around the 40s. Did they mention ever being restricted in any way?
So my understanding, and this is less from Mary Beal specific materials and more from other people who have written of the same era. So just to give everyone a little bit of background on this, the Desert Training Center was put together by General Patton during World War II. It was really in place from like 1942 to 1944. It was not there for that long, but it really was quite extensive. So it was in both California and Arizona, and really just took over a lot of the desert. They were doing these giant exercises. They were really interested in trying to integrate ground forces and air forces together as part of those exercises. So it really took up a lot of desert land. So I mentioned the town of Goffs earlier, as being where the Mojave Desert Historical and Conservation Association is. And they, so Goffs was actually like had an airstrip that was related to, an airstrip that was related to the Desert Training Center. So it was really just like a big boom for the desert at that time. For a lot of people who were living in the desert, especially in places like Daggett, they didn't really do exercises next to the towns. However, places like Mitchell Caverns, for example, or what is now a lot of the Mojave Preserve were affected. It seems like most of the time, the people, they were just hoping that they would get left alone by the Desert Training Center folks. So there were like some people who were doing cattle ranching in parts of what is now the Mojave National Preserve who complained because the troops would shoot their cows and eat them, which understandably I would get grumpy about that too. If my cow, especially there's not that much grass there, I'd be pretty mad. If my like cows who are eating my limited supply of grass are dying because of the military folks. But really it seems like people tried to avoid each other. That was like the best strategy. And so like people like Mary Beal probably just tried to avoid the general patent types. And then I also see in the chat, Angelina put out, right, that the Providence Mountain State Park, right, has this Mary Beal Nature Trail. You can go hike on it. I've been working with interpretation with the folks who work at the state park to try to put some more of this information that I've uncovered in my research about her into their interpretation out at the park. So you can find that hopefully in the future.
Cool. You have to keep us updated so that we can share that link to our mailing list and that becomes available if there's any.
Got to send them some more stuff so that they can get all of that put together. So, and then it looks like we have another question. If Mary ever met Minerva Hoyt, probably not. So I don't have any record like saying that they met, but the reason why I say they probably didn't meet is that Minerva Hoyt was like a big deal in Pasadena, and the Pasadena scene of horticulturalists, and horticulturalists are very different from these botanists. So like botanists love like going outside, looking at stuff, finding plants, and horticulturalists are more like high, like serious high society people who like don't like hiking. So like all these pictures of Minerva Hoyt always have her like wearing furs and stuff, and like Mary Beal, not a fur kind of lady. And so they probably wouldn't have crossed paths as a result of that, unless Minerva made it a, like a habit to go to Barstow, which I don't think that she did. But they, I mean, there is a likelihood that they would have heard from heard of each other because they were roughly contemporaries.
Cool. Does anybody else have any questions? I think we're about it. Thank you so much, Julia. This was so informative. I feel so much more connected to just the desert and in general, just from so many gossips that you were able to share with us. That was really cool. So thank you for that. We also want to thank the Desert Institute and the Joshua Tree National Park Association. If you guys enjoyed this talk and would like to see more in the future, please donate. There's a button right here under our screen, but there's also, if you're on the website, you can find it in the upper right corner. Julia is going to be back for two more talks, part of this history series. And the next one is going to be on July 10th, which is going to be about the jackrabbit homesteading in the Mojave. And then on July 24th, she'll be back to talk about the golden era of Desert Magazine, which I think we all got a little bug for after this talk. And we also have more programming in the making for Desert Live. So stay tuned, sign up for our newsletter if you're not part of it yet, and just stay tuned on the Instagram for all our future endeavors. So thank you everyone for joining us today, and we'll see you soon.
All right. Bye.
Thanks, Julia. Bye-bye.